Amen. You may be seated, please. All right, welcome to our final day, all right, of our pastors and ministers conference. I'm sure we have all been greatly blessed, all right, and have some relevant insights into what to do. All right, without taking too much time, so how we're going to do it is we have the first speaker, Pastor Hal, second speaker, Pastor Leah, and then we have a question and answer, and then we close, and then you go home. All right, then. I'm taking them to the Redeemed Camp to go for sightseeing. And then tomorrow we'll go and visit the Ark. All right. Let's welcome Pastor Hal from Heart of God Church, Singapore.
Good morning, everybody. Is everybody good? Yes. Please be seated. Thank you for standing. Let's give Jesus a big, big hand clap. And hey, I'm looking at you. Let's all keep the smiles on our faces. Turn to your neighbor and say, you look better smiling. Amen. I cannot believe that we are in the final day already. Wow, I am going to miss you, especially your worship. Oh, after you have experienced your Nigerian worship, I can never be the same again. You guys are just amazing. The worship team is amazing. Give the worship team a big hand clap. So, well, one thing you can do is that you are welcome to come to Singapore. But another reason is that, if you want to look at generations at work, yeah, obviously, we welcome you to Singapore. But you can also be in this church. Look at what Pastor Poju, Pastor Towin are doing here. This is a generational church. This is a church that is believing and empowering young people. Last night was incredible. Young people responding to Jesus. Last night, the young people are free and they are stepping into their destiny. So, right here in Nigeria, if you want to learn about generations and youth work, you make sure you learn from this church. Amen? Amen. All right. So with this, I want to, as this is our final day, I want to present a small gift to Pastor Poju and Pastor Towin. So Pastor Leah, can you come up? And pastors, will you come up on stage? Come, let's do it here. Thank you, Christian. All right. Come, pastors. So, Pastor Leah, you want to do the honors? We have a little gift for you. And this is the Nigerian flags, and this is the Singapore flag. And with this gift, this is symbolic of the partnership of Heart of God Church, Generations, and Covenant Nation, and also of Singapore and Nigeria Christians and churches. And so, when you see this and when you see the Singapore flag, remember to pray for us. Because we need the revival that you have. We need the prayers that you have. You guys absolutely pray and praise more than Singaporeans. And your revival here, I mean, all the revival, the churches you're building is incredible. So pray for us, okay? So, Pastor, thank you very much. It's an honor to be here. Yeah, I hope you like the game. So, should we take a picture? No, I'm good. Thank you, Pastor. Come, give them a big hand clap. All right. So since this is the final session, I need to add a few things, say a few things before I go into my message today. So first of all, I need you to know, and everyone listening online, especially you have listened the last 2 days, that I want you to know that generations, the vision, the concept of generations doesn't change your church vision. It doesn't change what the Lord has put into your hearts as leaders and senior pastors. It doesn't change it. Generations is not meant to replace or to hijack the vision of your church. So if the Lord has given your church and you as senior pastors a blueprint, so for example, your church vision could be church planting. It could be humanitarian work. It could be missions. It could be social work, social justice. Whatever the vision and mission of your church, generations do not come to replace it. So what generations does is that generations will help you raise up an army of young people who will help you fulfill the vision that God has for you. So I do not want you to go back and say, from now on, we are a generations church, or we are a youth church. Now, for Heart of God Church, it's different. We are a youth church because that's the vision that God gave to us, to influence churches and pastors around the world to focus on young people. That's our mission. But for you, what the Lord has given to you stays the same. I have more respect for you, and I have honor for the Lord that I will never say that generations is a more important vision than what the Lord has for you. Amen? So go back and continue what you have been doing, but continue, as you continue, you want to add strength. You want to add youth into your church. So when you empower young people, they will power your church. So generations, the way I see it, it's like your operating system on your phone. You see, God has a design for every phone, but the operating system, that's the one, it helps you build stronger, it helps you build younger, and with that, it will help you fulfill your vision in a greater way. So, one more time, generations adds to the foundation of your church vision, all right? So it doesn't destroy, it doesn't change, it doesn't demolish the foundation of your church vision. It just adds onto it and it empowers your young people. Amen? Amen. Everybody got it?
Yes.
All right. The next thing I want to address is that I've been preaching, Pastor Lee and I, generations all over the world, and pastors come to our conference from all over the world. And one of the questions people ask us when they are not Asian, they will say, is this an Asian thing? You know, does it only work in Singapore? Maybe it will not work in Europe or America. Maybe it will not work in Africa. So that's the question in everybody's mind. And I get it, because we want to be able to have a model and a principle that works in our culture. Now, I tell them this, obviously, you cannot copy and paste. We are teaching you the principles and the model, but you need to have wisdom to apply it, to implement it. You need to have wisdom to learn how to adapt to your culture and to your church. So one of the best examples is Pastor Eddie and Pastor Bola, and they are here. They are from Kent in the UK, and they came to the conference last year. And so it has not even been a year, and they have started implementing generations into their church, into their churches. They have almost 2,000 people in the UK. And they tell us that when they start to put in generations, the young people, instead of being absolutely tired and lethargic during worship, they are alive during worship. Instead of the parents dragging them to church on Sunday, now the kids are pushing the parents, I want to go to church, we are getting late. So I just want to play a little video of their testimony, all right? So they are right here, but they recorded a nice video. They have wisdom and they have the insight to be able to implement generations. So let's play the video.
Here
we pastored Gateway Chapel in Kent in United Kingdom.
Yes, last year we took a team and went to the Heart of God Church Conference in Singapore.
I actually had a vision for my young people, but I just didn't know how to actualize it. And a friend of mine told me about this conference, and we took a team out there. And one of the things that we learned is that it's a principle of ownership, that we should allow our young people own their process. And secondly, they are here to reinforce us and not to replace us. You know what? We came back, hit the ground running, and it's been so wonderful.
I tell you, it's been transformational for them. And for us as a whole church and a community as well. Now we can tell very clearly that this works anywhere and everywhere.
Absolutely. And we believe that the best is yet to come with future generations here at Gateway Chapel.
Amen.
Hello, my name is Abby Olabode and I lead NXL. NXL is the youth ministry of Gateway Chapel. NXL stands for Next Leaders. And our mission is to raise generations of leaders.
At the beginning of the year, our NXL services were in Haberdashers. There we had a lot of fun and a lot of fellowship. However, there was something missing, something that more that we could do. Our senior pastors shared with us the vision that they had for our youths. Our youths are not to be underestimated. They're not just leaders of tomorrow, but they're leaders of today.
In Singapore, we met with pastors and leaders from all over the world, all of whom shared the same vision and passion for young people as we did. It was amazing to see young people leading live in motion. It was fantastic to see young people as young as 16 mentoring others of 13 years old in different departments, from media to choir. As a team, we're so excited to come back home to start to implement the plan we started to pull together and to share the vision for a youth-led church.
Armed with fresh fire and a new vision, we are ready to take our youth ministry to a vibrant youth-led church. We kicked off our 8-week discipleship class, which laid the foundation for our move to Camp David, where the young people would be in charge of running the entire service. Relaunch night was an absolute blast. The youth were running their very first service. From the sound to the media projection to praise and worship, our young people were at the front of it all and have been at the front of it every Saturday since then. It's been such a blessing to see young people empowered and taking ownership of their spiritual growth. So much so that their service doesn't stop on Saturday, they also serve on Sundays in their various ministries. Since our relaunch, it's clear that they are learning, they are growing, and more importantly, they are bonding as they serve together. We are truly building a generational church, and I cannot wait to see what next year brings.
When I come to church on Saturday, it feels like a warm community, like I'm with my friends and family, and it's a great place to grow and be together in the Spirit of the Lord. Leading bits of church yourself has brought us closer to God, as not only are you with people your age, but you're together as a community, growing stronger and closer. At the beginning, I was really nervous, as I've never held a camera before, but as weeks went by, I became more confident and I grew in my skill of photography. And now I'm so confident that I'm able to teach the others how to do photography.
As a leader here in NXL, I serve in the NXL Youth Choir, and this allows the younger kids to see that a boy my age can sing and do praise and worship here at church, and this will make them think that they can do the same thing and they can do it anywhere else.
When I'm serving in the ushering ministries, I like it because of the way it has to give energy and high-five everyone before they come in.
We have instruments, we have mics, we have all of these stuff just so we can praise God from like our heart.
This year has been great, and along with 25 mentors, we've loved working with the young people, and it's been so great to see them grow and come into leaders.
Looking at what we've accomplished now, it was definitely possible, but at the time it just seemed so wow.
Ooh, they are here. Pastor Eddie, Pastor Bola, will you stand up? Come on, give that a big, big hand clap. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for the video. Thank you. All right, so it is possible. It is not rocket science. It is simple. It is not easy, but it is simple. And every church everywhere in the world can put generations into the church, and it will empower the young people to fulfill your vision. Amen? All right, can we get started? Okay, I want to talk today, and the title is God Has No Grandchildren. God has no grandchildren. And here is the paradox. The paradox is that we are talking about generations, and God is a God of generations, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. But yet, God has no grandchildren, because we never pray our grandfather in heaven. We pray our Father in heaven. So, to all the young people, I always say this, that it cannot be your dad's God or your mom's church, because it cannot be grandfather God. It has to be my Father God. So, God wants a personal, direct relationship with every single person. And especially, I say to the pastor's kids, the PKs, that God has no grandchildren. You need a personal, direct relationship with Jesus. Amen? So, when I go to churches and I hear that they are losing their second generation, their third, fourth generation, I feel so burdened about it. Now, it doesn't happen here in Covenant Nation. For you, it is amazing. I talk to so many young people, and they are second, third, fourth generation. They are in church. They have a personal relationship with God. They are on fire for Jesus. But you here is an exception. What you're doing here is an outlier. Most churches in the world are losing their kids. So, how do we stop this? How do we stop this attrition rate of the second, third generation? You got to understand that there is a major difference in how you minister to first generation or second, third gen. How you communicate, how you become a role model to the second, third generation. So, are you ready? The first difference is this that we need to understand. First generation Christians, they meet Christ before they know Christians. But the second, third, fourth generation Christians, they know Christians before they meet Christ. So, for example, for first generation, we meet Christ before we know a lot of Christians, especially in countries where there's very few Christian. Like, for example, for me, I grew up in Singapore, and we don't have a lot of Christians in Singapore. So I meet Christ first. I have an encounter with the Lord, and I have a personal relationship with Him first before I meet other Christians. However, the second, third generation, they grow up in church. Their families and friends, their parents, families, and friends, they are all Christians. So they meet Christian first when they are 4 years old, 7 years old, 13 years old, before they have a personal relationship with God. Now, unfortunately, we all know that sometimes in our churches, there are Christians who are very judgmental. Yes? If you're not saying yes, maybe you are one of those. Unfortunately, in our churches, we have Christians who have bad testimonies. We have Christians who are hypocritical. I want to be honest with you. I know. Like, I'm a pastor. I know my church. I know my congregation. So when we have our daughter, we keep our daughter away from some people in church. And I just surround her with the people who bear a good testimony. People who will not judge my daughter. Because there, unfortunately, are Christians in church who are very judgmental, very religious. So here's the problem. The second, third generation, they grow up in church and they meet these Christians who have bad testimony before they meet Christ. You see, for me, it's different. I meet Christ first before I meet any other Christian. I had an encounter with him. So I know that God is forgiving. Christ is loving. Christ is gracious. Christ wants the best for me. He died for me on the cross to give me a hope and a future. I know that God is good. But for the 9-year-old, for the 13-year-old, he does not know that yet. He doesn't know Christ personally. So all he knows about Christ are from the Christians. And unfortunately, sometimes Christians are not very good representative of Christ. And so they say, if this is Christianity, I do not want any part of it. Isn't it Gandhi who said, I like your Christ, but if not for your Christians. I like your Bible, I like your Christ, but because of the Christians, I will not be a Christian. So the second, third generation, they grow up, unfortunately, knowing Christians who misrepresent Christ. But for us, we know how to differentiate. Number two, are you ready? Number two, first generation Christians, they meet God before they know the church. Whereas second, third generation Christians, they know the church before they meet God. In other words, second, third generation, guess what? When they are babies, they are in church. They grow up in church. So they know the songs. They know when to stand up and sit down. They know that when you pray, but you are actually falling asleep. You pretend that you are praying, but you're falling asleep. They know which corner of the church to go so that they can hide, so that the pastors do not see them. That is second, third generation. So they know the church before they know Christ. They have been immunized from the power of the church. They have been immunized from the presence of God. Next, first generation Christians, they meet God. First generation, they meet Jesus before they know the Bible. Second generation Christians, they know the Bible before they know the Bible before they meet Jesus. So the problem is this: the second generation, they grew up in Sunday school, they grew up in children's church, and they know the stories of David and Goliath. They know the stories of Samson. But they do not know the God behind those stories. They know David, but they do not know the God of David. So they, to them, it's just stories. It is like watching Disney. It is like fairy tales. It is just another story. And unfortunately, Disney tells the story better than us. So they have been inoculated from the Bible. So for me, I was a brand new Christian. So my first few weeks in church, I sat there and the preacher talked about David and Goliath. I was like, wow, really? Wow, slaying the giant, it blew my mind. Like, wow, God is so powerful. But you take a 13-year-old who grew up in church, David and Goliath, they shut down. Been there, done that, bought the t-shirt. I heard it 100 times. So the Bible, and let me say this accurately, the Bible, it never loses its power, but when it's presented in a way that is not communicating to the second generation, when it loses its relevance to them, that dilutes the power of the Bible. Do you understand this? So when you minister to first generation or second, third, fourth generation Christian, it has to be different. The problem is, in our churches, the Bible is communicated to the Gen Z in a boring way, in a way that is not relevant to them, and they begin to shut down. All right? And so we must find a way to communicate to them better. And that is why, for us, our children's church, our Sunday school, this is how I think, this is our philosophy. And sometimes I get criticized by religious Christians, all right? Because in our Sunday school, we do not want to make it a school because the kids already have schools from Monday to Friday. So they don't want more homework. They don't want to take tests. They do not want to memorize the scriptures. Now, don't get me wrong. Memorizing the scriptures is very important. We need to put it in our hearts. But for the kids who have not had a personal relationship and encounter with God, to them, it is just more work, more obligation. So, until the point where the child have a personal encounter with Jesus himself, from here till that point, and every child is different, you need to keep them coming to church. You need to keep them interested. You need to keep them attracted to church. Now, we do not know when they will encounter God, but our job is to keep them coming, and when they come, they are not shut down. You know what's shut down? Have you seen a kid do this? Have you seen those? If they are in this mode, you cannot get through to them, and it's hard to God, for God to touch them. Yes, I know God can do the miraculous, but still, if they are not open, it's harder. So from here to that point, you got to keep it interesting. So again, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying we entertain the kids. Pastor Leah said clearly, it's not about entertainment, it's about empowerment. But we got to keep them interested. So I talked to one youth, and he was very interesting. About 15, 16 years old, he got an encounter with God. He got on fire. But till then, when he was born, till 15, 16 years old, he hated church. He was saying, like, the moment I can be independent, I'm never going to come back to church. I hated church. But he got his encounter. So one day I was talking to him. I said, wow, you know, 16, you encountered God. So I know you hated church the last 10 years. So what made you come back? He says, number one, my parents. I had no choice. But number two, are you ready for the answer? Number two, ice cream. Because in our children's church, every week we try to give out ice cream. We try to give out something fun, a little toy for the kids. And the ice cream kept him coming. So don't think, that's the flesh. You are using the fleshly appetites to lure the church. No. Don't think like last night when we have dance and party, like last night. Do not think that that is worldly. Do not think that is fleshly. Because there are many Christians, kids out there who have not had that revelation. So it is this stuff. It is the ice cream that God then come back for 10 years until he finally had an encounter God. I am so glad I've been giving out ice cream every week. If ice cream can get so safe, I'm going to give everybody ice cream. Amen. So that's why in our Heart Kids, we call it Heart Kids, our children's church, this is one of the things we do. Secondly, it is the power and the presence of God. In your kids' church, in your youth church, it is so important because it's the power and the presence. Make sure you pray for them individually. You prophesy over them. When they encounter God, then you have succeeded. It is not about the numbers. It is about getting second, third, fourth generation kids to encounter God and have a personal relationship with God. Amen? Amen. All right. So we need a church that can win the second, third generation. So the Bible must be communicated in a relevant way for the young people. The church must be built and designed in a way. The services on stage has to be designed in a way that is relevant for young people. Amen? So the thing is this, ask yourself this question. When you step into a church, when imagine a new person, a youth, stepping into your church, a 16-year-old, is your church, the environment, the atmosphere, the people, the vibes, that's a new word, is the 16-year-old more comfortable or the 40-year-old more comfortable? See, if your church is designed for the 40-year-old to feel more comfortable, the 16 will not. But if the 16-year-old feels comfortable, like, I like this, guess what? The 40-year-old will not feel comfortable. So for me, I would have, if you have the resources, have different services to cater to different age group. But if I don't have a choice, I will definitely be on the side of the young people. Because the adults, they are mature. They are supposed to compromise so that the young people enjoy it. Amen? Are you getting me? All right. Can I go on a little bit more? So, we all have heard of the story of the prodigal son. Everyone, we have preached it 100 times already. But let me tell you, it is not the prodigal son, but it's actually the prodigal sons. God gave me this revelation. Two sons, one strayed, but the other one stayed, but they are both lost. One is lost in the world, but the other is lost in the house. So it is not just the one who left. The one who stayed is also lost. The prodigal son, one was far from home. The other was near home. The other was at home. But near does not mean close to the father. When you are in the house of God, it doesn't mean you are close, you are intimate with the Father God. Just because kids are in the house does not mean they are close to the Father. Proximity does not mean intimacy. So don't just think that we need to get them into the church. And the one who is in the world is lost. Just because they are in church do not mean they are on fire for Jesus. So it is the story of the prodigal sons. In fact, to me, the one who is in trouble is the older brother. Because we know that the younger brother repented and came back. And he came back a changed man. But this parable never talked anything about the older brother. We do not know what happens to him. He is close in the house, but never close to the father. Amen? So I want to read to you Luke chapter 15. And I want you to see it from a different eyes. See it from the perspective of the older brother and the perspective of the father, not just the lost son. So let's go to chapter 15 and verse 24. It says here, verse 24, "For this son of mine, he was dead and now he has returned to life. He was lost and now he is found. So let the party begin." All right. Hey, guys, you need to make some noise here. When I read this in the NLT version, I am like, what? God the Father actually said this. Let the party begin. I do not know what image you have about God the Father. We may think that he's a serious, strict, fierce old man in heaven with a big stick and waiting for your sin. We think that God is like a moral police. You did something wrong. I'm going to get you. I am watching. I do not know what kind of image of God we have painted to our children and grandchildren. That in order to educate them or correct them, maybe we have painted the wrong image of God to our grandchildren, to our children. That God will judge you. God will curse you. Now, I know there's a legit fear of God. That's a good, healthy fear of God. But when we paint God as a judgmental God, a God who is always trying to point out your faults to them, they run away. But Jesus says, the Bible says, there is no condemnation in Christ. Condemnation is different from convictions. We do not want our children to feel condemnation. We want them to feel conviction. And you know what's the difference? Condemnation makes them run away from God. Convictions makes them come to God. We need them to be convicted. So here you can see God the Father as a God who is joyful. He likes celebration. He likes a party. I'm not sure you can get that in your mind. God likes a party. But the thing is this, you guys know how to party. I see the way you worship. I see the way you are at the front. You know your God is a God who likes to dance, who likes music. And that brings me to the next verse. It says here, verse 25. It says here, "Meanwhile, the older son was in the fields working, and when he returned, the older son, he heard music and dancing. The music was so loud that when he was outside the house, he heard it." So, when our God parties, it's not soft, slow music. When our God throws a party, it is not, let's have solitude and silence. Let me tell you, when our God throws a party, it is so loud, the neighbors could hear it. Across the road, they could hear it. Even before the older brother entered the house, he already heard the party, the music and the dancing. See, this is the God that we have. Amen? Okay, let's go on. So the brother, the older brother, let's drop down to verse 28. The older brother was angry and wouldn't go in. And his father came out and begged him. The older brother is what we call a religious Christian. Is it the same here? When we say in Singapore, a religious Christian, it's not a compliment. It is somebody who is, what's the word? Who is like a moral police, who is hypocritical, judgmental. Is it the same here? All right, so when someone says, you are a religious Christian, don't say thank you. It's not a compliment, right? The older brother is a religious Christian. He got upset when God is joyful, when people are joyful. And he refused to go in. He refused to join the party. He got upset with the brother. He got upset with God himself. Let me tell you, religious people don't like dancing and music. They see it as worldly. Like last night, the youth rally, religious people will say that that's worldly. But let me tell you, it is not worldly. It is a Gen Z way of worshiping God. Religious people don't like loud music. Religious people don't like dancing. You know, in our church, we have our fair share of criticisms from other religious Christians. They say this, see, look at the HOGC youth. It's all hype. It's all shallow. The way they grow their youth is they compromise, they're worldly. And that's why the young people are attracted to them, because they compromise. We are holy. We never compromise. Even though we only have three youths. But we are the remnant of the Lord. And they say, look at the HOGC youth. Look at the way they party. You know what they say? Our church is called HOGC, Heart of God Church. They call us Heart of God Club. They meant it as an insult. I take it as a compliment. Because the young people love to come to our church. And let me tell you, the lost, the unchurched, they come to our church, right? So we have our leaders and our core members, and then you have the unchurched and the lost. And they come. Oh, and the dressing of the girls. I mean, you would think that they do not have enough cloth. Because everything is too short. It's short here, it's short here, it's low here. And they come, and people will judge. See? HOGC youth. The way they dress. And they will judge. And the lost kids, they come to our church. In our toilets, our usher will find cigarettes. Well, now you don't have cigarettes anymore, you have vaping. And they find it all in our toilets. But let me tell you, first of all, these are not our leaders or our core members. Okay, the leaders, they have grown, they have matured, they have discipled. So they dress differently, they are different. But I am happy that these kids are in our church. Would you rather them be in church dressed like this or in the clubs in the world? Let me ask you, if you have a daughter who is lost, who has backslidden, and she's dressing really wow, crazy, all right? And you say, I would ask her to change. Well, that ship has sailed. Like they have grown up. They do what they want to do. So in that scenario, would you rather your daughter dress like this to church or in a club? Church. Because in the church, there's no alcohol. In the church, there is no man, no predator targeting them. I'm going to get you. Church is a safe space. So if we can provide a safe space for them to party, I'm so proud. I'm so proud that they can do this. And they're coming every week, every week. They are belonging before they are believing. And we are not judging them. Because the moment you judge them, the moment you tell them, the way you wear, next week, change. The way you speak, your F-bombs and your curse words, you cannot do that in church. They're not coming back. But they come. And then one day, 6 months later, 2 years later, they encounter the power of God and they get saved. That's what we want. Then they will change their dressing. So I'm not saying that we do not correct them. I'm not saying we do not disciple them. I'm saying it's the timing. When they are ready, then you disciple them. They will change when they have Jesus inside of them. You must understand, change is not external. Change is not behavior modification. I know some people who look very Christian, but are sinful on the inside. Change has to be an internal transformation, a renewal of the mind. And that's what we are going for. So you cannot enforce a change. But it will come when they encounter God. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Are you learning something today? Yes. Let the church be a place of clean, wholesome fun. Amen? Yes. Hallelujah. You know, when I see these kids come, I don't judge them because they're in the mosh pit. I stand, but Pastor Leah will join them in the mosh pit. When I see these kids, I have so much compassion. I understand what Jesus meant when he said, I see them as sheep without shepherd. I saw all these kids. They are just lost. They are just looking for love in the wrong places with the wrong people. Let them come. Don't judge them. Listen, people are coming to church. They are not coming to court. I say one more time. People are coming to church. They are not coming to court for us to judge them. God is the judge, not us. You know what the Bible teaches us? In a court of law, we are not called to be the judge or jury. We are not called to be the prosecuting attorney or lawyer, right? What did God ask us to be in a court of law? Witnesses. We are just called to be witnesses, not the judge, not the prosecuting lawyer. We are the witnesses of Jesus, witnessing his power and his love and his grace. Amen. So finally, before I'm done, I want to show you this. There's a movie that's very popular, a Christian movie called Jesus Revolution. Are you familiar with it? If you are not, go watch it. It's about the revival in America in the 60s and the 70s. And it's a hippies revival. You know, the flower power, the Woodstock era. The hippies in those days, the kids, they were on drugs, they were psychedelic, they were believing in free sex and free love. It was all bad. And the church didn't know what to do with them, and the church pushed them away. But you know that God, go read history, God started a revival among these kids. So this movie is about that, Jesus Revolution. And I want to play a little clip of that. And it shows that when one pastor, Chuck Smith, he had a revelation that God loved these kids no matter how messed up they are, he opened the doors of his church and invited them in. And when he invited them in, the religious people in his church really got upset. So let's play the video.
Since I opened up the door, call ourselves Love Song because, well, we sing songs about love, real love. Dig it? Thank you to Pastor Chuck for having us come through.
Thank you, fellas. It sounds great. This is truth. This is life. This is God's word. Let's open it together.
This is enough. This is a house of worship. And yes, we expect a certain level of dignity here. These girls are wearing halter tops, and half of them aren't even wearing shoes.
They're staining the new shag carpet with their bare feet.
A carpet? Yeah. Oh. Yeah, let's be sure to say it's a carpet.
You keep this up, and you're going to drive away the only contributing members that we've got. You hearing me now?
Loud and clear.
Amen. Now this true story, it grew and became one of the greatest revival in American history. The heart of God is to embrace all these young people. Amen. And I have a second clip for you. So just let's, I love the second clip because we are all confronted with a choice. Us and in your churches. Would you be someone who embraced the young people? Or would you be the prodigal son's older brother who judged them? Watch your next clip.
This place, it is yours.
I don't care if anybody else thinks so. If you feel like you're an outcast, then join us here. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, this is where you belong. If you feel ashamed or trapped in something you've done or are doing, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here. No guilt trips. This is your home. And I want you to tell all your friends about it. There is a place for you. Now that door is open all the time for you, any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door is open for you too. It works both ways.
Let's begin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we have a choice. Will we exit that door? We cross over and stand and sit with the young people. You know, I play this video, I preach this message to my own church, and I told all the older people in our church, you have the choice. And I say the same thing. The door works both ways. My church, Heart of God Church, the door is always open to youth. No matter how messed up they are, no matter if they're on drugs, they're on alcohol, they're in sin, bring them here. No matter how they look, no matter how they dress, no matter if they have tattoos everywhere, bring them in. Bring them in. That's the Church of Jesus Christ. The Church of Jesus is built for sinners, not for the saints. Our churches are built for sinners. Our churches are built for people, kids especially, who is looking for their Savior, for Jesus. Let them in. But I tell my church, they say, hey, the door works both ways. If you don't resonate with what we're doing in Heart of God Church, it's all right. There are 700 churches in Singapore, and you be blessed. You will grow in those other churches. But here, this is what we are all about. And let me finish up with this. I've read the story of the prodigal son or sons all my life, 100 times. I've never seen this. And one day God showed me, and I was just totally in tears. In verse 15, verse 28, it says, the older brother was angry, wouldn't go in. And his father came out and begged him. And when I read this, I felt God speak to me. Tell the church, don't make me beg. How could we make our father beg? Can you imagine that we can be so religious that our Father in heaven would beg you? I mean, you cannot imagine even on this earth. Can you imagine on this earth that like a pastor Pochu will go to the elders of the church and beg the elders of the church, please let the youth come in? You were like, that is sacrilegious, that's blasphemous. How could you let Pastor Pochu beg? But you know what we've done? The older brother, so religious, that he made the father beg him. Don't make God beg. I love my God. I will never do anything to dishonor my God. Don't let our God beg. Amen. Amen. God wants his lost sons to come home. God wants to throw a party. Let him come home. Stand up with me. God, we are sorry. We repent before you. If in any way we made you beg, you are the God of the universe. You don't have to beg. You could have just judged us. You could have just punished us. But yet, in your kindness, in your grace, you beg. You beg so that your other child, your other son can come home. So God, I will not make you beg. God, my church will not make you beg, because we honor you, we love you, we worship you. So today, wherever you are, online, in person, if you want to say, I want to open my heart to the young people, especially when they are messed up and sinning, I want to open my heart, I want to open my home, I want to open my church to them. And God, I love you too much to make you beg. Forgive me. And for those people who criticize, the religious people who go online and attack and put nasty comments, God, we know. We know that you are not judging them, but you are begging them. If that's you, you want to open up your hearts, your home, your church, to young people. Lift up your hands right now. 1, 2, and 3. Hallelujah. Father, you see all these hands here. A new generation of pastors and leaders who will carry your heart, the heart of God. A new generation who will welcome sinners, welcome young people into their homes, into their churches. And God, I pray that they will have the courage to do so. I pray they will have the strength to do so when they are criticized, when people who misunderstand, who don't have that revelation, God, that will be gracious back, that will say, like you say on the cross, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. But it doesn't matter what they say or think. But for us, we now have heard your word. And for us, we will open our hearts to young people. Let them come in. And Father, we know, as Pastor Godwin says, that's only the beginning. It begins with belong, but it doesn't stop there. Then we know, then they will believe, and then they will become disciples. Thank you, Jesus. But the first step is to welcome them. The first step is to build a home. So Father, you see all this in. Bless them. Give them strength, courage, wisdom to do what they do, to raise up young people and generations in the churches. Thank you. I pray all this in Jesus' name. And everybody say, come on, let's give Jesus a big shout. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's have a party. Come on. Music, dancing. Hallelujah. You have a God who knows how to party. You have a God who likes loud music. Come on, give him one more big shout.